continuing our study of Sutta Discovery, volume 41. We are nearing the end of the volume already. Perhaps the next lesson we would have completed all the suttas here, because the last section, the short suttas, they are all overlapping, many of them coming from the same chapter, and all of them deal with the topic of Samadhi. Now, Samadhi, as we know, is such an important word, it has been adopted as an English word. We can find it in the bigger dictionaries, like the Oxford English Dictionary, like the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, and so on. Usually when we adopt a foreign word into English, we normally leave out the what I call the diacritics. Of course, in many occasions you can also still see many of those diacritics, especially words which are borrowed from French, for example. So, on the other hand, even if you don't use the diacritics, all those non-English markings are still okay. But those markings help us to remember how to pronounce the word properly. For example, Samadhi, the second letter, you see that the A has always called a metron. Metron means a line above the vowel. It's always a vowel. And gives it two counts, a long sound. In other words, one, two, and then Samadhi. Funny in Sanskrit, very exact, but they even follow this timing. It's very musical, so you can chant it in a very beautiful way. So the proper pronunciation shall be Samadhi. Okay, Samadhi, the long vowel is in the second part. The long vowel is the second part. So Samadhi has a quite a broad sense of meanings, actually. Of course, the usual translation for Samadhi is concentration, or to be more exact, mental concentration. In other words, the mind concentrates, focuses on a single mental object. Of course, there are some scholars, some monks have done lots of study of the suttas. They suggest or they think that concentration is not a very good translation. They have their reasons, so they say it's better to translate as stillness, mental stillness. But translation is a quite tricky thing. Depends how you look at the context, and you find you may have to translate differently for different contexts. In other words, how the word is used in that particular passage. Stillness is not exactly wrong, it's not totally right either. Because we have another word for stillness in Bali. We have words like samatha, right? Samatha can mean stillness. Then we have upasama, also can mean stillness. So it's quite tricky translating into English. That is why we have many different translations, and no single translation is perfect. In fact, there's no such thing as a perfect translation. Famous literary writers would tell us a translation is actually a new work. It's a totally new work. So if you study library science, which I did when I was in secondary school, well, not exactly library science, but we did a practical aspect of library science. We were learning how to classify books, how to arrange the books, and so on. We have to learn about all the 10 classes of knowledge and things like that. So, when we talk about stillness of the mind, and in the context of how stillness is used, so we got to, in other words, decide how is it used in this context. So, for example, if you take samadhi, sama samadhi, as a factor number, that's number 7, right? Or is it now number 8, sama samadhi, yeah, the last factor. They refer to the 4 satipatthana. For sati, what is it, samadhi?
Last one is right view.
No, no, first one is right view. Samadhi refers to what they call the jhanas, okay? The jhanas, another deep concentration, okay? But you can take samadhi in the broad sense of the word, meaning not a concentration, but mental focus. So in terms of mental focus, you also can include the four focuses of mindfulness, right? So it depends on the context. Samadhi is a broad sense, meaning when you bring the mind to a stable state, it becomes calm, it becomes still. So in a sense, stillness is not wrong, because when the mind is focused, becomes one, it is also very still, very peaceful. But this word stillness again is problematic, because although the mind is very peaceful, the mind is also joyful, exuberant, for example, in jhana, right? So, in a sense it's peaceful, but in a sense it's also active. So it's quite tricky when we use words to describe the focused mind. But the words give us an idea of what's going on when we meditate, in other words. Then we have another word called ekagata. Ekagata, in full, chittasa ekagata. Chittasa means of the mind. Ekagata, one pointedness of the mind. Okay? Here, if you know German, it's very helpful to understand that this word ekagata is compound. The German language is full of compounds, some very long compounds. So ekagata, you have to resolve it. No, sukrakata has eka meaning one, plus aga. Aga means point, and then the ta ending makes it into an abstract noun. By Englishness, you know, goodness, right, and then so on. Okay, so ekagata, right? Ekagata, that's how you pronounce it. One pointedness of the mind. What is the one point here? So basically, we start off with, for example, the breath, loving kindness, whatever meditation object that you are using, you focus on that. Finally, I've completed the 49, SD49.5B, which is about how to attain dhyana. So, all the put together those topics on the 10 or 11 kasinas. So, you have 10 different kinds of kasinas, which are also meditation objects. Kasinas usually tend to be external meditation objects. This is very interesting. If they're external, we normally call them kasinas. If they are internal, then they are usually called, you can use the dhammas. In the commentaries, they use aramana. So in English, they say mental object. In other case, you can say mental object. One is internal, the other is external. In the kasinas, they use the four elements, for example, earth, water, fire, wind. As you know, the four elements you can see within yourself, within outside yourself too. And then you have the four kinds of colors, right? White, yellow, blue, and red. Okay? So we can use these colors. Color meditation is very interesting because, you know, some people like certain colors. So this is where in color meditation, you select the kind of color that suits your personality. And you find it soothing, it calms you down, you use it, right? And then you have the space kasina and this light kasina. Now when you come to space and light kasina, there's a simpler version of it. They're called perception of light, perception of space. And this is a very simple meditation to do. In fact, some of the modern psychologists have been experimenting with these things without even knowing the idea of kasina. But when you look at the way they experiment, you say, wow, yeah, it's very interesting, you can relate to it, and you may even, they may even help you understand the nature of Kasinata. I remember long ago seeing a documentary where this lady, this woman was suffering from a kind of seasonal depression. You know, these countries in the north where they have 1 month, 6 months of darkness, right? And they get very depressed. I mean, when you have this kind of haze from Indonesia for 6 months, you get to get quite depressed after a while because you don't see the sun, it's really very dark. Right? So imagine, you know, this woman is feeling so terribly sad and depressed. Used to see a psychiatrist, and this psychiatrist or therapist used light therapy. And I remember seeing this picture in this documentary video, where this woman is sitting in front of a big wall of lights, long lamps, bright white lights. Those something like this, but not so strong. So the lights are bright, but they are diffused, so they won't have the eyes. So she's just sitting there, bathing herself in this bright light. That's her therapy. Of course, some people may wonder, how does this work, you know? And the moment I saw that, I said, wow, that's light. Perception of light, okay? So perception of light is simply to acknowledge there is this brightness outside us. So it's a very simple meditation to do. You can do it anyway, you know? So if you see, especially in an open space, very nice place, and it's early in the morning, not too early though, say when the sun is already up, because it's very bright, you sit in a comfortable place, you see this open space in front of you, bright, very bright, especially open sky, clear sky. There should not be any other objects, whether it's distracted, it should be kind of open in space, or better still, something bright as in that your eyes. So just sit there, and your object of meditation is brightness, the light. So you observe the brightness, internalize it, picture the brightness in your mind. You can use the word light or bright, slowly, repeating a few times, and then remembering you are recording this brightness in your mind. And then when it goes away, open your eyes again, look at the brightness. So this one meditation you do with open eyes, so to speak. Open eyes, close eyes, back and forth, again and again, habitually, until you, in the night when you feel sleepy, or anytime you feel sleepy, you can just close your eyes and then you recall brightness. You see this brightness in your mind, okay? The sutras are very interesting. They actually tell you how you know this perception of light has worked. They say that if in the night you can bring up this brightness in your mind, then you succeed in it. Right? So that's perception of light. Light kasina is a kind of a next step, a very interesting approach. Light kasina is where, let's say, you pull up one of these curtains here, you know, and you sit here and just watch the bright light. And that's one way. You see the bright light and you meditate on it. Okay? You look at it. Or you sometimes you see a beam of light, as we say, shining through the trees. In the early sutta instruction, the meditation methods are very simple, very natural. Okay? A beam of light, a bright beam of light shining through the shadows of a tree, or there's a hole in the wall and sunlight is shining through, right? And some of course there's some very ingenious methods also. According to another ancient book called the Vimutti Magga, written by Upatissa, probably in India, he suggested putting a bowl of water in the sunlight. And then the sun will shine in such a way that the light will reflect onto the wall. Okay? So there's an angle there. And then you see this brightness on the wall. And you reflect on that brightness. Of course, the thing is this, you know, the sun is going to move, you know, so this light also is going to move. So you got to be prepared for that too. Right? So anyway, so that's, you have the perception of light and you have light kasina. Okay? What about space? the perspective of space also is helpful in a similar way to the light kasina. It helps us feel open and happy, so it's very good for treating people with depression. So imagine in the future they're going to use all these wonderful Buddhist practices, you know, which become really very simply practical and useful and healing. In the case of space perception, because you know, space is just the way of doing it similar. You sit in this wonderful place, very spacious, very open in front of you. Up on a hill, you see this fantastic open valley in front of you. Or maybe from the top of a mountain, maybe. And there's no obstruction. So this time, instead of using the perception of light, you say space. So you feel the spaciousness of earth. Space. Okay? And I think this is a very good healing method, therapy for those who have claustrophobia. Right? So they have this idea of space. So there you are, these are different, two very simple perception methods and also asana methods. So once you reach a level of calm and focus, we call it samadhi. Okay, any of these methods of meditation can produce samadhi. So it has a broad sense of meaning, which is broader than jhana. Jhana, very often when we use it, when we talk about the four jhanas, because we refer to a very special kind of deep, profound mental concentration, where we have totally transcended the five senses, or even the six senses, if you like. Why is this so important? Because remember, what is it that distracts us from meditation, or more exactly from getting mental focus, from getting samadhi, are the five senses, right? For example, you are listening to me now, you're not just listening, you have to process what I'm saying. And then something you don't understand, you start thinking, and something you understand, say, oh, I like it, you know, so there's a lot of interaction going on. So your mind is all the time watching, doing. So it's focused, yes, but there is attention, it's called manasikara. So it's a very important term. Manasikara means your mind attends, your senses attend to what's going on. Right? So when the senses are involved, the word for attention and focus is manasikara. Manasikara, that means attention. Okay? Whereas in deep meditation, we say samadhi. We don't say manasikara. The manasikara is action. Kara means you act on it. Whereas samadhi is a stillness. Right? So, but both there is what in English we say as attention. Okay? But it's a different kind of, two different kind of attention. The first is an active attention, and in a sense, in meditation, there is the passive kind of attention. Here, active passive is used in that sense. We have to be very careful about language. Some people, they become technical with language. Technical means they insist that there's only one meaning for one word, which is impossible actually, not technical. Words have a range of meaning. It has a broad range and it overlaps other words and so on. So we're talking about a range of senses. Even when we talk about colors in the suttas, we have the color kasinas, red, yellow, blue, white. Now red, yellow, white shouldn't be problematic, but blue, we translate as blue, but it's problematic when translated as blue. It is important to put in brackets after blue the word nila. N-I with a macron over the I, long I sound, nila. Nila is not exactly blue. Although blue is a hue of it. See, because this is where we have to understand how the ancient Indians look at colors. The moment we say, if I tell you blue, I don't know what image comes to your mind. It will be the color you are familiar with, you know? And it's not going to be the same blue that I have in mind. And to make matters more complicated, you could get an artist, you know, these artists are even more familiar with colors. They have all kinds of fantastic names for colors, a particular hue. And some of this view we don't get in certain cultures. Right? For example, there's a color called Sienese. Frankly, I can't remember what this color is. It's a name after Siena in Italy, where they produce this particular color. Because they use certain maybe plants, shells, materials found in their place, and they got this color and they like this color and they use it to paint pictures to certain moods. And this is what makes the artist great and special. They know how to combine these colors. So in India, when you say blue, you have a range of colors, and you're going to be surprised when I tell you this range. It can range from Nila is often translated as sky blue, sky gray, or cloud gray. Cloud gray. Usually, if you say cloud gray, you wouldn't be wrong. Okay? But the Buddha's eyes are often described as Nila also. So one translator translated this as blue. Just Nila, blue, dictionary translation. I can imagine the Buddha having blue eyes. It's just totally wrong. I mean, you don't have blue eyes in North India. Unless they're Europeans, you know. I mean, even among the Europeans, you don't have everyone having blue eyes. So I remember there was this online chat, you know. So they were saying, okay, you have blue eyes, and then there's this person with brown eyes, and quite upset. He says, that's not fair. I've got all this, even the Buddha has got blue eyes, why not brown eyes? And I said, oh, we should not be too concerned about this kind of words, no, because it doesn't really mean blue the way we see it. You know? Actually, I trusted in the suttas as black, dark. So blue, nila can also mean dark, because I tell myself, why does the sutta use the nila? Imagine what kind of eyes the Indians have. You look at all an average Indian, another Indian or India, the race is not mixed, okay? They all invariably have dark eyes. Obviously, that's the word, it means dark. And yes, the nila does describe the cloud gray, the dark sky when there's a storm, when the storm is brewing. You know? I mean, you imagine, you've got to imagine natural colors. You see a dark sky, that's called nila. And then you see the dark skin of Krishna, you know, this Indian girl, they also call nila. But that's a kind of dark blue. Any of these Indian girls, they wear colirium, they line eyeliners, you know, right? It is also called nila, but it's black. So we cannot say, okay, nila is only one color, blue is, oh dear, so how do you fit in this? Black. So in other words, the Indians have a range. When they say blue, they have this range of meaning. Of course, by our monastery, we say, oh, that's not accurate. It's not the point of accuracy here. That's the way the ancient Indians see colors. That if you go to other cultures, they have their own range of colors also. And if you study colors, you'll see this problem. Okay? So, in other words, in the Buddha's time, there's this broad sense of words, even sense of time. Right? The idea of time is more generous than we today. So once you understand this context of usage of colors, then it's easier for you to meditate on these colors, knowing there's a range. Within one color, there's a range of colors, and you choose the kind of color within that range that helps you. Okay? Of course, some teachers, if you go to some meditation teachers, they may insist you use a certain hue, and they will explain why. Then you have to follow the instructions. So this is, as a student, it's good to try out until you get the right effect. And then once you know the system, yeah, then only you can change the system. Because you don't change the system, you don't know nothing about it. So here, broad sense of the meaning, okay? The idea is we use all this to attain samadhi. And when you are really focused, when you overcome, you transcend the senses, then you attain jhana. Jhana means you are no more troubled by the five senses. What you see, hear, smell, taste, touch, they temporarily shut down. You don't have to deal with them. You only deal with the mind. In fact, this is what we do when we have a problem to solve, especially if you're a writer, okay? Or even when solving, say, a mathematical problem, you know, if you have this meditative problem, they do. You sit quietly, usually one way people sit quietly and then they don't do anything, they just focus. So it's a mental process, so to speak. Right? But the difference meditation is, once you have settled the five physical senses, next thing we need to settle is that so-called mental process. Because that mental process also processing information. Processing information, it uses language. And language is a medium. The medium is not the message. Okay? You got to, what's the message? It's on the other side, so to speak. Okay? So you got to look directly at the breath, for example. So this mental process is thinking, worrying, ideating, meditating, and so on. So we have to calm that down also. Okay? I think the word samadhi can include that there is a bit of mental process, but it's not as distracting as when all the five senses are active. But when the mental process also stops and the mind is really calm and still and focused and joyful, then you have jhana. And the Sanskrit word is dhyana. Notice there's a long vowel. The first vowel is long. Dhyana. And the word jhana, in usage-wise, in the early suttas, we find jhana has two meanings. One meaning is simply meditation. So this is where jhana overlaps with samadhi. In terms of meditation, even in Thailand, you know, there are many words for meditation. For example, we can say nam samadhi. Nam is to sit. Okay? Sit in samadhi is to meditate. So jhana can also mean meditation in the suttas. But from the context you can know, jhana also means a very deep, profound state. Okay, this is where we get some very interesting situations. For example, I can say this because online, you know, we have all these recordings of various talks by different monks. There is one monk, I think his name is Tadama, if I'm mistaken. He's one of these computer monks, but he also teaches meditation. If I remember correctly, he's a student of Praksulangala Empire. His idea is that you don't need jhanas. You see, you don't need jhanas. I don't know whether he goes on to the exam saying that Buddha did not teach jhanas, but he may as well have thought like that, because he made this very strong statement. He says that the word jhana means meditation. It just means meditation. But to be quite frank, I think that is a very limited definition of jhana. Jhana has got two meanings. Because you could have a lot of problems if someone asks you, okay, what about in the Samanya Bala Sutta? That is a Digha Nikaya Sutta number 2. And in many other suttas where the Buddha described first jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana. Right? So you could have a problem when the kind of question is asked. Right? So jhana has two senses. In the sense of profound, joyful states of mind, free of the senses, and simply meditation. Okay, so many of these words overlap, but they depend on how they are used. We cannot say they are unclear, it depends on the context. This kind of, I would like to use the word versatility. Pali is a very versatile language when it talks about the mind. The mind is so dynamic and you know, interesting. You cannot just pinpoint it, that's it. So you have to, the words also have to be dynamic to allow the student to have the benefit of the doubt, as you said, right? So slowly the student understands one part and then extend the idea until slowly understands the meaning of the samadhi, jhana, much better. Then what are the words do we have left for one hour, right? Oh, kamatana. Okay, kamatana seems to be a later word. Many of these long compound words should come later. It's probably commentarial. Kama, as you know, means action. Kana means a state. Of course, we can also rewrite this word up as kama plus atana. Now, if you translate kama tana just as it is, it means a state of working. It doesn't mean much there. But the moment you say kama tana, it means meditation here. And it's another word in Thailand for meditation. We say nan kama tana. So you see that's the way the Thai pronounce it, the tone, kamatana. Kamatana pronounces kamatana. So kamatana can also be explained as, I think better explained as, the action of stabilizing the mind. Attana, to stabilize the mind. Stabilize the mind means samadhi. So there you are, you have another word for meditation. It doesn't really matter how interesting I can explain it using all these etymological ways. Important thing is, it's talking about mental focus. Okay, so we have three words, samadhi, jhana, kamatana, they can all mean meditation. But they have their own special meaning too. Okay? Then you have one last, very important word, I would say, when we talk about meditation, this last word is the most important, samadhi, bhavana. Bhavana. Bhavana translates as cultivation. Cultivation, or some translators use the word development. And here again, in Thai we say nam bhavana. Nam bhavana, they pronounce as bhavana. Okay? Also means to sit in meditation. Okay? But bhavana has a very beautiful meaning. It means cultivate, to cultivate the mind. It comes from the root word, from the root bhu. Okay? All these words in Pali have a root. The root is the essential meaning, if you like. And then from the root you have the stem. Stem word, okay? Stem word refers to the word which is the bare word. We don't usually use the word in conversation here. It is a word which is used in the dictionary for listing. That's called the stem word. For example, kamatana. Kamatana is a stem word. In the suttas, you never find the word kamatana spelled like that. It'll be kamatano, kamatanan, kamatane, kamatanena, and so on. It also be declined. Like in English, you say someone's book with a apostrophe S and so on. So you have root, you have stem. This is paspali. Yeah? So this bhavana, the root wu means to be. To be or is. Okay? Usually to be. Yeah? There's another root, us. A with the long macron us means to be, is. What you mean to say is, who normally you say to be. So, bhavati means to be. So, when you meditate, you become. Okay, very interesting, we're talking. Eh? In other words, you grow. So, there are many, now we start thinking of the meanings of this word. To be, to grow. Right? To be something means you and that object is not different. You are peaceful. So when you meditate, you are peaceful. You become peaceful. Right? The other word is the verb to have. So in English, your verb to be, verb to have, and a verb to do. Okay? In a sense, in meditation, we say, cut down on the verbs to do. Alright? And then let go of the verbs to have. And then cultivate the verbs to be. It is a grammar of spirituality. Okay. I love this part of, I love in literature. When you combine the study of beauty and literature, and then you talk about meditation, this is what you see, the beauty of language describing beautiful states of mind. So, for example, I can say I have a car. I can even say I have a lot of money, or I have great fame. But what you have, you can lose. We use the word have to connect something outside which is not really yours to yourself. It shows a sign of false ownership. You don't really can own these things, right? Whereas if you say you are, it's different. I can't say I am the cup. It doesn't make sense, you know? Right? We say it doesn't make sense. Because the cup is out there. It is made of four elements. Okay? But if you say I am the four elements, then it makes sense. Because we have the earth element, water element, fire element, wind element, inside us. If you say I am happy, it makes sense because you and the joy is not mediated anymore. You feel it inside you. So in meditation, we want to have a direct experience of reality, not second-hand or third-hand, but those are not real experiences, although they may be helpful. So bhavana to be has got a very deep and wonderful and beautiful meaning in meditation. You become what you really should be, or whom you really are, so to speak. You discover your true self. True self means no self. Right? Okay, so that's notice you can say so many beautiful things about meditation. And I've not come to this topic yet. Okay, that's the one more. Have I finished all the words already?
Yes.
Alright, all done. Very good. So now we come to the first sutta for the day. Given this long introduction, you have a better idea about my book. Page 143, chapter 14. Yeah? Right, as usual, we shall look at the title, Himavanta Sutta. Himavanta is the sutta name for the Himalayas, the mountain range. The Himalaya Discourse, A6.24. Right? So here we can see that it comes from the book of sixes in the Anguttara. Anguttara, mind you, not Samyutta. So here, in other words, this is the collection for laymen, teaching for lay people in meditation. And here the theme is meditation attainment is able to shatter mountains. Wow, this is rather interesting, huh? Because Himavanta refers to the mountains. Here, the idea is that if you really go deep into meditation, you can attain such great powers, that psychic powers, you can zap a mountain away, like what you see in those Star Wars movies. Huh? Fortunately, we don't really see all these things happening nowadays. That means people have not attained jhanas, or if they did, they're probably very judicious, very careful not to use their powers to destroy nature. Right? It's not very helpful. But there are stories in the ancient text which talks about some of these less scrupulous gurus or meditators who use their power in such a way that the whole forest is destroyed. But even then, that kind of destruction is not total, you know, because the forest will grow back. Okay? At least in some most cases. Anyway, that's not the point in meditation, as you know. It's just that in meditation, what the sutta is trying to tell us, what Buddhism is trying to tell us, is that meditation is such a powerful act. It is an understanding of the mind, and it is from that understanding comes all the power that have created us. But whatever we see around us, this building, this wonderful invention you see around you, the comfort we are enjoying, is because of our mind. Mind is the greatest creator, is the true creator in that sense. Okay, now just to first start off, to make you familiar with the sutta talks of six things. It is summarized for you on page 143. The sutta talks about being skilled in attaining samadhi. Can you see the six things then? Section 2. Being skilled in remaining in samadhi. Being skilled in emerging from samadhi. Being skilled in keeping fit for samadhi, being skilled in the resort for samadhi, being skilled in the samadhi resolution. So these are six aspects of meditation we need to master. And the other two suttas mentioned on the board, they mention most of these things plus one or two other qualities. So I'm treating these three suttas together because they're covering, they're talking about many same things. Okay, page 144, the Himalaya Discourse, A6.24. Bhikshus, among accomplished in six things, might shatter the Himalayas, the king of mountains. So what is there to speak of vile ignorance? Notice the language here. Sorry?
144,
yes. Okay. So, here, now, this is where understanding literature is very useful when we look at the suttas. Because some people, when they look at sutta, they say, oh, what this sutta is talking in an exaggerated way, hyperbolic. We're talking about dramatization. We're talking about the message and the medium. Okay? How do you impress an idea on others? Sometimes we just say that something as it is, we find people don't take it seriously, right? You know, I've been watching some Dickens shows, some really nice movies made from Dickens stories. Charles Dickens was a professional writer. So he has to produce every month, every few weeks, he has to produce installments to his all his famous stories. And that's all he does. And he writes really well. And people go crazy about him when he finishes the story. So it's like a soap opera today. Many of his stories talk about suffering the children to go through. When I read and watched many of the shows about his works, I could have to say, wow, you see, because the stories are done over the time of Queen Victoria, that's the height of British colonialism. It's not wrong if we say that the British colonial empire is based on child slave labor. Because in England, during that time, child labor went on rampant. And of course there were laws during Victoria's time also trying to change this. And one of the people who were very outspoken about this problem was Charles Dickens. He wrote some of these stories which are so dramatic, so graphic. Look at Oliver Twist, for example. Look at the story of the old curiosity shop. There's so many of these stories that he has written about where young people have to suffer. And in Nicholas Nickleby, you see these children, they have to labor. And 12 hours a day. Sometimes they're not paid, they're just fed. Many of them are orphans, they like to fight, this British. And many of these soldiers die and their children are left orphans. So these children work in the, many of these children they work in these factories, very dark and gloomy. So, and the stories are very beautiful, but some of them, because critics say he tends to exaggerate all these ideas, all these problems, they're not really that bad, the situation is not really that bad. But if he wrote in a very nice way, nobody would read his books, because it's nothing interesting to read. But because it's over-dramatized, they are interested in it. A young child dies, somebody is to suffer so much injustice, a woman gets raped by the rich, couldn't do anything about it. So this grips them. These are real problems. So the Buddha also is a great storyteller. So if you look at early Buddhism as literature, this particular aspect, exaggeration, then you find it's okay. I mean, we can accept all the fantastic, countless million Ganges Sen, Buddhas, and Bodhisattvas. But what the Buddha says here is not so dramatic, so to speak, right? But still very real. So look at this passage again. Bhikshus, among accomplished in six things, might shatter the Himalayas, king of the mountains. What's the Buddha talking about? He's saying, wow, if you really meditate and you have all these great mental powers, you can destroy, it's possible to destroy this big mountain. Right? Of course, we can take for example in the sense that once you're when you did meditation, you understand this mountain is nothing but earth element. So in that sense, you have destroyed the concept of mountain. It's one way of looking at it, right? More than that will be very philosophical, of course. But the next phrase is, so what is there to speak of vile ignorance? In other words, the Buddha is saying, ignorance can help you in any way to be safe in the mountains. The mountains will destroy you if you are ignorant. See? So that's one way of looking at it. But that's not what the Buddha is really want to talk about here. He's talking about meditation. He's saying if you understand your mind, you understand the mountains, you understand everything around you. And what is it he really wants to talk about? The real thing is in verse 2. Here we choose a monk is skilled in attaining of samadhi. He is skilled in remaining in samadhi. He is skilled in emerging from samadhi. He is skilled in keeping himself fit for samadhi. He is skilled in resort for samadhi. He is skilled in samadhi resolution. Right? Notice the word used here is samadhi, not jhana. Okay? So here, in other words, meditation in general, calming yourself, even though you may not attain jhana. Simple meditation. Like when you do loving kindness meditation, when you do breath meditation, the kind of meditation you all have been doing. Okay? And you attain some moments of peace. The last paragraph says, bhikkhus among accomplished in these six things might shatter the Himalayas. Not as though it's might, it didn't say will, it said might shatter the Himalayas. The king of mountains, so what is there to speak of vile ignorance? So see it in context. Here the Buddha is talking about wisdom versus ignorance. So, what do these six qualities mean? They have given a short commentary on them, on the page 143, section 2.1, skill in attaining of samadhi. How do we attain samadhi quickly, properly? You remember in many of my meditation, I always without fail tell the class, in your meditation, smile. Smile at the peace, smile at the breath. Be happy when you meditate. If you meditate happily, you can focus better, right? So, in other words, you should gladden yourself when you meditate. The Pali word is Hasetva. Hasetva can also mean to laugh, by the way, but the general meaning is to be happy, to smile when you meditate. You know, I'm very surprised that actually some people tell me they can't smile when they meditate. So, I told them, well, you got to go back and practice. Get up in the morning, go to the toilet glass, toilet mirror, just smile. You can't just use your fingers and push them up, practice. And then look at the happy pictures and imagine your mind. So that you start there, being happy. But happiness is a habit. So once you have that ability to smile inside yourself, then easier to see the meditation object. How is that? When you smile, it is incongruous with, say, angry feelings, negative thoughts. Then they won't come in, they get pushed away. So you push away distractions that way. It's easier to focus on the mental object. So this is the key instruction to remember, to start happy, to do loving kindness, for example. Right? And there are many happy instructions, many happy stories, inspiring stories in the suttas. So that is why meditation teachers will encourage you outside meditation to study the suttas. The suttas are there to help you to meditate. They're not there to help you to get an MA or PhD and earn a living. Well, some people do that, but the real point is they're there to help us understand the background, nature, methods, benefits of meditation. So the suttas help us in that sense. Yeah? Now then you have number 2.2, skill in remaining in samadhi. How do we stay in this wonderful peace of mind? Here again, it's very interesting some of the feedback I get from people who meditate, beginners especially. some of them were very new to meditation and they don't receive any instructions. They felt they were sitting down doing their own breath meditation, they read somewhere and they were practicing it. And then suddenly they thought they have stopped breathing. And then they panicked and said, oh dear, I'm going to suffocate. And they forced themselves to breathe. I said, why do you do that? That's the whole idea in meditation, you know. You sit quietly, your breath slows down, you become more peaceful. There comes a point where you are so peaceful, you need less oxygen, so to speak. You're so calm and peaceful, your heart rate, your blood pressure, everything goes down, your breathing slows down. You are peaceful. So your task now is to sustain, to hold the peace. Once you reach that state of peace, smile at it. That's one way you keep it stable, the peacefulness. Or if you notice any disruption coming, you say, peaceful, peaceful. To keep your mind, to bring your mind back to this wonderful peace before you, around you, enveloping you. So, in other words, you stop counting the breath, you stop saying it out, you don't say anything. You just silently, peacefully enjoy this peace. Maybe we can say enjoy, but we can't hear. You just totally surrender yourself, accept this peacefulness. That's how you can stay a long time in meditation without thinking, without processes of the mind. You just let the peace totally envelop your whole being. That's how you sustain, you remain in Samadhi. Then number three, skill in emerging from Samadhi. When do you come out of Samadhi? Well, this is not so difficult. It's more like when you're starting to meditate, just before starting actually, you kind of like tell yourself, okay, I'm going to sit for 15 minutes, 1 hour. You time yourself once. Of course, if you like, you have a digital clock in front of you. So once you have this kind of focus, your body clock will naturally work. So around 1 hour, give it take a few minutes, you will come out of the meditation. Okay? So this is the emerging from meditation. Yeah? Notice here, the sutta says, is able to emerge from dhyana at a predetermined time by the body clock, or he is wise in knowing the time limit in regards to emerging, thinking, I will exert myself as long as the sun is gone. That means during the night. Huh? So as long as the sun is gone. So when the sun rises, I will come out. So this is how you put the message into your mind. So it's like there is something in your mind that records this instruction and will act on it. I mean, you don't have to go into meditation to notice, you know. For example, let's say tomorrow you have an important appointment, right? And you, for some reason you don't have any clocks, right? And then you tell yourself, wow, tomorrow I must get up at 5 a.m. because I have this important appointment at 7, you know, so you have to prepare yourself, prepare you for the journey. So you more or less, you sleep on time and you tell yourself, I'm going to do this. And then you find, you do just that. Your mind, like, you know, becomes active again at 5 o'clock, more or less. So it is something natural, something possible for us to do. But if we don't use this habit, we don't cultivate this habit, then we might lose the habit. Just go on sleeping. Right? So, as I said, these are habits we cultivate and they become more, we become better as we go on doing. 2.4, skill in keeping fit for Samadhi. It's very important to be healthy, to be able to meditate well. You can take the sense generally as being healthy. In other words, eating not too little, not too much, just enough, and eating the right kind of food, answering nature's call. Even for meditators, they need to exercise, and they do it by walking up and down. They don't have to do all those modern ones like Pilates and gymnastics, you know. That can be distracting, you know. Unless you're a professional, and it is another story anyway. So we do walking up and down, okay, to help our circulation. At the same time, maintain our mindfulness. We are not exercising the body for the body's sake. We are exercising the body for the mind's sake, to speak, for the sake of mental focus. So as you do your walking meditation, your body, the circulation is held and so on. So keeping fit is very important. Notice here it says, he is capable in keeping the mind fit for dhyana, keeping it adaptable, happy, bright. He also knows the suitability of different kinds of kasinas. So here, in other words, you also understand when you need to switch your meditation, right? When to do breath meditation, when to do loving kindness meditation, when to do color meditation, when to do element meditation, and so on. Then number five, skill in Samadhi resort. Okay, here it refers to how to deal with those mental object when it arises. Okay? That's one meaning, knowing whether it's right for you or not. Okay, that's one. But I think the broader sense is more helpful here. Resort also refers to the kind of place, environment that you are using. For example, if you are meditating at home, certain times it's very noisy, so it's not the resort, it's not good, you say. So choose a quiet time, maybe early morning, late night, right? That's one way at home. Another way is to look for a suitable place outside, say in the park or somewhere in the beside the lake, a beautiful reservoir. So a proper place which is very peaceful, safe, comfortable, we use that place for meditation. Nature is very beautiful and important to us in this sense. And number six, resolution. Okay, here he's able to direct his mind to the first dhyana and on to higher dhyanas too. Right? So here, in other words, once you attain certain level of calmness, you go on letting go of other distractions and thoughts. You direct your mind towards dhyana. You reach total transcendence of the senses. But this, for some of us, we might be able to get it, some may not. So we try our best to resolve the mind so that we can attain samadhi, dhyana in due course as far as possible. Even if we can't, we can still use this peaceful mind to reflect on impermanence. So there you are, these are six things we need to learn in terms of Samadhi. Now, next sutta is Samadhi Bala Sutta, okay, page 145.
Number four, the word kasina.
Yes, kasina, yeah, refers to meditation using external objects.
External.
Like colors, the four elements. Yeah, that's a simple way of putting it.
Okay, the second question I have on this is this. I'm just speaking as a layman's point of view.
Okay.
So if somebody is able to go into jhana, whether it's first, second, whatever it is, now is it correct to say that during the jhana period, let's say 15 minutes or half an hour, he will be in a state of bliss, maybe?
Yes.
So when he comes out of it, normally the mind is so, you know, precious.
Oh.
We go back to a lot of mundane things.
Yeah, true.
So when we say keeping the mind bright and happy and adaptable, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's very true. I mean, if you come up jhana and you go straight into the world, you feel the world's gone mad. Yeah, a lot of people will run. You don't have to get into jhana to do that. You go for a 7-day retreat in the mountains and you come back to the office, you say, this is crazy, you can sense that. Okay? That is why normally we come back into the world gradually, slowly, that's one thing. Another thing also, we want to change our lifestyle so that we don't lose that kind of wonderful state of mind. Otherwise, you get back to the old ways, you feel unhappy. It's not that you lose the jhana, it's you forget about it, or you don't have the right conditions to feel that way. especially if people are new to it. But there are some who, by nature, are so calm and so okay, you see, like some, you know, Dharma teachers, meditation teachers. But the rule is this: if you really want to cultivate this jhana, this properly, you when you come out of it, you got to make sure that you remember those things through review, and then you lead a life which will kind of not contradict those things that you've been beautifully experiencing. At the same time, you maintain those happy states, and you, wherever you go, you exude this kind of peace, people also can feel it. But generally, if you're a beginner, yes, you may lose it, but it doesn't mean you should not cultivate it again. So we got to do it regularly. That is how people go for retreats, occasions.
It's a process of time.
Yeah. Sorry?
It's a process of time.
Time and habit, yeah.
Yeah, because we are talking about lay people,
obviously. That's why we got to go for periodic retreats, like, yeah. You can go on your own. Yeah. But you have a nice, beautiful place somewhere, very nice and peaceful. You have monks there, and you have the proper food there also, and environment, and then you have a program for meditation. That's great. Or you can do it on your own. Okay? All right, now let's go on to the Samadhi Bala Sutta, SD 41-15, the discourse on strength. The Bala means strength, spiritual strength in Samadhi, A6.72. And here the theme is how to strengthen your meditation. So this is another theme, is dealing with the same topic. So look at, here again the sutta mentions all the six things. Look at page 147. The sutta is given to us. So here there are two parts. The first part is negative, when we lose strength. Second part is when we gain strength in samadhi, in meditation. Bhikshus possessing six things, a man is incapable of attaining strength or power in samadhi. In other words, we weaken our mind. What are the six? Here Bhikshus, a man is not skilled in attaining samadhi. He is not skilled in remaining in samadhi. He is not skilled in emerging from samadhi. He does not practice with care. Okay, number four is new, right? Number five, he does not practice with commitment or persistence. Number five also is new. Number six, he does not do what is suitable. Number six also is new. So these are the six things that prevents a monk from strengthening his meditation. Then the closing part is just the opposite, right? So if you have the six things, you will strengthen your meditation, will gain power, you will strengthen, you will build up. I'll just say number four. Here we choose a monk is skilled in attaining the attaining of samadhi, is skilled in remaining in samadhi, is skilled in emerging from samadhi, he practices with care, he practices with commitment, and he does what is suitable. So this, let's look at 4, 5, 6. Now look at the short commentaries in page 145. Practices with care, what does this mean? Okay, the commentary says, he acts with care so as to be able to enter dhyana. This also means executing all his duties, chores, and tasks diligently, performing deeds of merit, such as giving and other wholesome acts as a support for the practice. Simply put, is not heedless. Now this is a very interesting point, practicing with care. In other words, you have to tell yourself, meditation is not just when I sit, you know, it's my whole life. So if I, here I am trying to meditate, and then in the evening I go for a drink and I get drunk, you know, or I start doing crazy things, and I have this business that has one cheating people, you know, it's not going to work. So meditation is not something, you do something separate from your daily life. You cannot compartmentalize it. It's your whole being, right? So to practice with care, in a sense, a very important sense, means keeping the precepts also. Okay? Then 1.5, practicing with commitment. He keeps up his effort in working to attain the other. In other words, he puts in every effort he can into practice. It is said that true practitioners are committed to their duties. Duties means spiritual duties, yeah, dharma duties. Commitment means persistence of two kinds: continuity or sustained effort and proper effort. Okay? So you have, in other words, sustaining, keeping effort and doing it correctly, doing it rightly. This means persistently clearing the mind of any thoughts of the five parts of sense pleasures, not to get lost in the senses, and directing the mind constantly to reflect on the three characteristics: anicca, dukkha, anatta, impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and non-self. It also means to be patient with ourselves and never heedless. This commitment should be to at least attaining stupini. In short, it means enjoying the recluse's life and duties here and now. Right? Now, we need to understand the initial renunciation. It's not just becoming a monk or a nun. It means there are certain things we got to let go. Let's say if you do go for a retreat, you should not be bringing your handphone along, for one thing, right? Or if you do have your handphone, you switch it off. So you totally renounce the world, so to speak. The meaning of renunciation is letting go of the world for yourself, at least for a while, so that you can focus on the mind. So in that way, you're totally committed to meditation in that sense. Then you get the benefits. Doing what is suitable. That's the 1.6. Here, let's just look at some key ideas. He is able to fulfill those qualities that conduce to concentration. In other words, he knows what is beneficial to his practice and what is not. And of course, cultivates the former and lessens the latter. So, there's a story of a monk called Punna. He is happy as a monk and he wants to go into meditation. And he's got his brother who's a merchant, who loves him very much and takes care of him. So the moment his brother knows, or he's in a certain place, the brother will go there, and you know how brothers are, they're very close and loving. But he also distracts Punna from his meditation. So what Punna does is he quietly moves on to another village, another town, another hill. So he went on moving one place to another, and he found this one place by the sea, the water was lashing and hitting against the rocks, was so noisy and too noisy, so then he moved up to the hill. It was really peaceful there, meditated, and he became an arhat. So we have to be diligent in looking for a suitable place to meditate. People may tell us, oh, this retreat in Australia is a wonderful place. Well, maybe try it out, see how does it work for you. Maybe it's too, yes, it's a good place, but it's too popular, too many people, and you find you can't really do it properly. And you go to another one, a quieter one. Okay? I mean, once you know the method, there are many different places you can go to. So in that sense, it's a journey of our pilgrimage. We go, as we move, we learn. Whatever things we see around us, how people behave, how the teachers behave, rightly, wrongly, we learn from all these things. And our meditation improves in that sense. Okay? And then we come to the last sutta, which is page 148, Vasa Sutta. This is on the discourse on mastery, of course, because mastery of the mind. Now, if you look at the list, they are quite the same. We have seven qualities, page 148. Page 148, section 3. So here, the sevenfold quality masteries are mastery in Samadhi. So this one we have done before, it's the same thing. Mastery in the skill of attaining of Samadhi, skill in remaining in Samadhi, skill in emerging from Samadhi, the skill in keeping himself fit for Samadhi, skill in the resort for Samadhi, and skill in the resolution for Samadhi. So here, notice, we've done, already discussed all these things. So here you see certain, there are certain selections, right? One or two items are different, but the suttas basically talk about the same thing, depending on the audience, what they need. Buddha, the teacher, will teach them accordingly. So let's look at the sutta on page 149. There are two suttas, Vasa Sutta 1, Vasa Sutta 2. Vasa Sutta 1, A7.38A, if she was possessing seven qualities, a monk has mastery over his mind. Notice the word mastery over his mind. And the monk is not under the mind's power, or not the mind's obedient wife. So this is a literary play on words. What are the seven? Here it shows a monk is skilled in samadhi. He is skilled in attaining a samadhi. He is skilled in remaining in samadhi. He is skilled in emerging from samadhi. He is skilled in keeping himself fit for samadhi. He is skilled in resort for samadhi. He is skilled in the resolution for samadhi. It shows possessing these seven qualities, a monk has mastery over his mind. The mind is not under the mind's power. Then the closing sutta, Vasa Sutta 2, which shows possessing seven qualities, Sariputta has mastery over his mind, and Sariputta is not one under the mind's power. So here everything repeats itself, but this is mentioned specifically in connection with Sariputta. So here we see, in other words, these topics of the Dharma are being used in different occasions, different circumstances to be taught to different kinds of audiences, but they basically refer to the same teachings about samadhi. So do read up these things whenever you can, or these teachings, and then practice them. You don't have to read everything. Read what you can connect with, you feel joyful with, and you find that gives you the energy to go on reading other things. Remember, you know, I spent over a decade with these suttas, and it's not always easy to translate them. Just try, dedicate 1 year to translate suttas and try. You know, for example, after writing that essay on the ways of attaining dhyana, after that, I told myself, wow, I'm so happy I finished that one. I told myself, I don't feel like going on to the next one, because you just want to be happy. But there it is on the list. So what I do is I tell myself, okay, you know, let me just do a bit, you know, just get the Pali words. And then I don't think of, oh, I'm going to complete another volume. I don't think like that. I just say, here is a sutta in front of me. What does this verse say? So in other words, I'm only present to that particular passage at that time. If I think I got to turn, oh boy, I got another 20 volumes to finish, you know, by another 10 years or something, you'll give up. You'll feel so, oh no, what have I put myself into? I remember a meeting on very famous economist in Singapore, it's one of those top academicians. He asked for meditation, so I went to teach him. And he was kind of half reluctant because his friend recommended him to meditate. And he told me, you know, here's another thing to do. You know, I mean, isn't it wonderful you have one thing less to do? You know, saying. I said, yeah, meditation, that's what you do. You do so that you don't have to do it. You have less things to do. You know? So when you do sutta translation, you also think that way. You don't think in terms of, oh, I have so much to do. You just do what's before you. You don't worry about, can I complete all this in my whole life? Well, I mean, I can't complete the whole translation because it's so detailed, you know, but the fun in doing it, the joy in doing it, the meaningfulness in doing it, I just feel I can't do anything else. This is the best thing to do. Alright? So you feel happy in that sense, and you sit there happily. So what you're doing, you're recording your happiness. Isn't that wonderful? You're not trying to complete anything, but you are. And yet, here you are, every 3 months, without fail, one new volume. And today we're sending volume 47 for printing, okay? So that's one way of living with the Dharma. But you don't have to trust the suttas, but you can sit back, read the suttas. There are many people who are proofreading the suttas, and they also feel so happy with the right sutta. They realize, wow, the sutta actually very inspiring, not so difficult. There are simple ones, yes, there are difficult ones. But you can choose what you want to read, and these suttas transform our lives for the better. Okay.
Yes?
Yes? Ekagata means one pointedness of the mind. The mind is focused on, say, the breath, one point. Okay? It means basically all the other distractions push away, no more distractions.
And it is karma and life.
Meditation. Simply means the work of meditation. That means you take meditation as your task, as your work. It's a big word, meaning meditation. Okay.
Yes? Eka is one.
Eka means one, yes.
Aga
means point. Point. Aga can also mean foremost as an adjective. It can mean, but here it means point. Okay? One point. One point. Yes. Or you can say the foremost one, that's okay.
How you meditate colors?
Well, one way is you go to a garden and you see beautiful blue flowers. You know the interesting thing, one of my childhood flowers, we call it bunga telang in Malay, I don't know how many of you know it. It's the blue, bunga telang is the blue they use for cakes, you know. You can use it for meditation. Okay? Yeah. So you sit there in your garden, you look at the blue, but make sure the wind is not shaking the flower, like it's just the flower is very still, especially a big, beautiful flower in full blossom. You sit there. First thing the commentary said, you will notice the what they call the faults. For example, it's not all blue, the pistil or whatever inside will be white, and you have the other things around you which are different from blue. So you slowly lack of that, we just focus on the blue. So you see blue and then picture in your mind. Like now, even in my mind, I can, because my childhood flower, I've been seeing the flower for decades, you know, so I can imagine the blue here. So what you do is you focus to such a way, when it comes to the point, you close your eyes, you see blue, everything blue, totality. In fact, kasina, another meaning is totality. The blueness covers your whole being. Okay? And if you're happy with the blue color, it helps you to be happy, focused, and you go on doing it. Some people don't like blue, then you can use red. Okay? I think red are meant for more gentle people. Now, people with full anger should not use red. Okay? But then they see red, as we say. Right? And then you got yellow. Okay, again, there's a range of yellow. You've got to choose the right hue that suits you.
If you see colors, you can go into Samadhi.
Yeah, if you do it properly, calmly, you may, if you're happy, first, do you feel happy or not? You must know. If you're happy, then you go on doing it. If you don't feel happy, don't do it, because maybe it's not working. So there are four colors you can use, yeah? So each color has got a range of colors. So in fact, there are thousands of colors now, come to think of it. Okay? Any other question?
Is it correct to say that the difference between Vasa Sutta 1 and 2 is that Vasa Sutta 2 refers to Samadhi?
Yeah, it's the same thing. Samadhi. Yes, that's right. Yeah, you often get this kind of arrangement, you know, where one sutta is just a teaching, second sutta refers to someone. And then later on, some section, they even just repeat certain sutta, changing one teaching and so on. But we won't be studying that kind of sutta, but those are just to complete the sets.
Then how you emerge from Samadhi?
Well, your body clock, you time yourself, you say, okay, I'm going to sit for so long, you time yourself before you start, you tell yourself more or less. On the other hand, you can also just sit peacefully, but you know, in a sense, you know when to come up because you've got to take food, answer nature's call, so you more or less must know the time you're capable of sitting, so you have that idea in mind. For example, some people, they say, okay, I've been sitting for 40 minutes all this every day for the last week, so maybe I can try 1 hour today. So okay, you say, okay, I'm going to sit for 1 hour, something like that. So you try yourself at the start. Okay? You like you're setting the internal alarm, so to speak.
I think one easy way is to play a CD and the CD station to wake up.
There's a
restock
and resolution.
Resort is you find a suitable place, environment proper, everything is helps you to meditate, doesn't distract you, yes. And then resolution is you direct your mind so that you can get deeper and deeper into meditation and attain jhana if possible. That's So you can just go further as far as you can. Step by step, this is not in one day, obviously. These are done over a long period of time. But some people are very good, they can do faster, especially when they got more time.
Well, resort is to strengthen the...
No, resort means suitable environment. Okay?
So where is your
resort? I like nature, peaceful natural places. But you know, once you're good, it doesn't matter wherever you are, you just close your eyes and you don't need the environment. But of course, you got to have the habit first, no? You know. But of course, if you see a beautiful natural place, wow, that's the environment, the atmosphere. The Chinese use the word qi, they say, you know, this nice feeling, you know. Because somehow, the environment, for example, they say like near waterfall, you have this nice feeling. I don't know what is it. They have words like ions and all this stuff. It's a nice feeling when you're near a waterfall with nobody around. But don't go to this Johor, what's that place called?
Kota
Tinggi. Not too many people there. You got to pay to go in there, you know. You might trek into the forest and you find there's this beautiful cataract waterfall and there's no one there. You just sit there, you can see the waterfall in front of you. Even though it's noisy, but it's very peaceful. Internal is very, because after a while we get used to the sound of water, we filter away the water sound. It's there, but it doesn't trouble you. And you hear the sound of the cicadas, monkeys, but they also don't trouble. So we're used to this natural sound, that's one. Or you can go to Botanic Gardens. Botanic Gardens is a really wonderful place in Singapore to meditate. Find a suitable corner you like where people do not walk in front of you in a noisy way. In fact, the field near the Eco Lake, where the train station is, the open space is not too bad. Although children are playing there, they are playing a bit far away, and the place is so open, so the noise gets diffused, you know, disturb us when we meditate. Of course, if you are a beginner, you want really a quiet place, but you can go to retreat centers, they are really beautiful and quiet.
Isn't it resolution
to
strengthen the meditation?
Yeah, by going further, step by step, until you get better focus, more focus. And if possible, attain jhana. That means you strengthen your meditation by going further, going upwards, until you attain full jhana, by letting go of all the senses.
I saw a video. I think this was also reported in news about this Nepali young man. He's been jhana for years.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what it is, but we do talk about what's called cessation of feeling and sanya vidyuta, perception and feeling. But then the most is 7 days. Yeah, because the body cannot take care of that.
Yeah?
7 weeks. 7 weeks at the most. 7 weeks at the most. 49 days.
Did you take video of him?
Yeah. See, the thing is, you can see all this video, but I think it's best to stay there and watch it. Because videos you just see it for a few minutes. We don't really know what's going on. They've done a lot of reports on many of these wonderful things, but when you later they investigate, they found that actually it's something else. So what I'm saying is, certain things are possible, certain things are not possible. I mean, if you follow the suttas, for example, 49 days, that's sensible enough, you know. The Buddha didn't take food for, you don't take food for 1 day, so you're already complaining, you say, I'm so hungry, right? This is 7 weeks, you know. Obviously, he's not using the body so much, which is going to do meditation, so that's why he can sustain himself for so long. He only comes out every 7 days to answer nature's call, maybe drink a bit of water. I think that should be something proper, you see. And after 49 days, it takes food. It takes some offerings from the two merchants, remember. So if it doesn't, then you'll die. Now that's why those lay people, you know, when they become arahats, it is said they should become monks, otherwise they'll just die. You know? But I don't think they die the same day. Rather, once they become arahats, they're no more attached to the world. They don't care about the world. They don't get food. they're quite happy and they just meditate and then they pass away because they don't take food. Right? So, whereas if once they become monks, they got to follow rules. Get up in the morning, go for alms round, people ask questions, people answer. So the Vinaya also, in a sense, create the conditions for the monk to continue living for our benefit. So that's why, I think that's my understanding of why laymen arahats, they have to become monks. Otherwise they'll die. It's not that they cannot become arahats. They have no more desire and attachment. They're just happy to meditate and then without taking food they pass away eventually. But once they become monks and nuns, yeah, then they will continue living their natural lifespan. Let's go for today, right? Thanks, time is just nice, eh? I mean, okay, let's do a short reflection to finish off. We gather in peace when we look at the suttas. The suttas remind us how we can take this very important journey inwards. And this is a journey we must, as Buddhists, sooner or later take for our own peace of mind, for our own wisdom, so that we are free from suffering and not get caught up with the sufferings of the world. And then we prolong our suffering. Through understanding the suttas, we improve our meditation. And when our meditation gets better, our wisdom grows, our own peace of mind grows, and also benefit other people. So in this way, it is a win-win situation. Reflecting in this way is very good karma. Better part of such good karma, maybe be blessed with the wisdom and the courage and the commitment to aspire to attain at least extreme winning in this life itself. And by this same token of good deeds and various other good deeds we have been doing, practicing generosity, keeping the precepts, coming for sutta class, and many other good deeds, by all these good deeds and the power of three jewels, may all beings here be well and happy. May we also send out our loving kindness to everyone who's been working hard for this place, people who come here seeking the truth and the Dharma. May they find the true teacher. And also let us send our loving kindness to our loved ones. May they be well, may they be happy. And to those whom the Dharma have not touched, may they see the Dharma in this life itself. May all beings be well and happy. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.